Irina Kostenko wanted to talk about the 10th of March, the day the Russians killed her only son, Oleksiy. The two lived here just 500 meters from his job changing tires at a garage. Irina led the way to her son's bedroom, damaged by shelling weeks after he was killed. We were the first outsiders she'd seen since the Russians left on Friday, and the story of Oleksiy's death spilled out.
The pain is so bad. Now I'm all alone. My son was young, 27 years old. He wanted to stay alive.
Oleksiy was born when Irina was 18. Her life has not been easy, but she dreads the future without him. She said he'd served in the army, but that day he was going to work at the garage. After they killed her son, she fled and the Russian soldiers took over the house. And judging by the rubbish they left behind them, they were having a good time. Loads of bottles of vodka, Jack Daniels, Bell's whiskey, beer, you name it. It is hard to understand human behavior like this, but what makes it really tragic is that there are so many accounts of it happening where Russian soldiers have been and are now in Ukraine. On her own, Irina buried Oleksiy in the garden after she'd brought his body back from the road in a wheelbarrow.
I covered the grave with a blanket to protect it from the dogs. He isn't in a coffin. I had to roll him in a carpet.
But it only takes a moment to destroy a family. Irina found another picture of her son. This is my love, she said. My sweetheart. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, outside Kyiv.
That's a very sad situation for that woman to have to go through. You know, that according to that story, that's her only son. You know, and we didn't see her father in the house, so it was just her and her son. She had that son when she was 18 years old, and here comes the war. You know, and. You know, this thing comes you know, subtly, you know, and it's sad, man. It's sad, you know, when you see your kid, you know, shot up right in front of you, and there is nothing, absolutely nothing that you can do about it. Nothing. The only thing you can do after they leave is put your son like she did in a wheelbarrow. She don't have any money. I mean, it's not normal operation over there in Ukraine. It's not like she can go prepare for a funeral and stuff like that. They don't have no lights. They don't have electricity. They don't have power. They don't have food. They don't have water. Some people are dying of starvation over there. You know, looking at these things, man, it really makes you realize the little complaining that we do on a daily basis ain't nothing compared to what these people are going through. This is a very, very sad situation. That this woman lost her son, and she had to bury her son, not the normal way, but to bury her son in the ground and put a blanket over him so that the dogs won't get to him to eat him up, because I'm sure the dogs over there are starving. You know, humans can barely find something to eat. Can't nobody feed no dogs, you know. You know, this is real bad, man, and I felt like, you know, this country really needs prayer. You know, I don't know the whole situation on why they're going into this war. I don't know all that. All I know is that they are going through some difficult times. Very difficult times. And I mean, we have to realize, we have to acknowledge that at this moment we are blessed. We are fortunate to not have to be going through that. Just imagine any given day you could be in the house and your whole house can just be blown to smithereens. Any given day you could be going down the street or just walking outside for a fresh air and get shot up, riddled by bullets from the Russians. You know, so I don't know how a person can have a comfortable sleep. I don't think nobody could say, I'm going to sleep, I'm going to sleep 8-9 hours peacefully and go to sleep. You can't. It's terrifying going to sleep, because any little noise you hear, you don't know if that's the Russians outside getting ready to kick in your door. And man, I'm telling you, they got videos with them guys. When they show up, they torture you. They put a gun in the back of your head and they shoot the gun. And they torture you, burn your fingers up. They do a lot. And this stuff that they're doing is to the civilians. These civilians ain't got nothing to do with the government. See, these are really war crimes, because any time that two countries get into a war, it's always supposed to be military against military, government against government. The civilians are supposed to be off the schedule, off the radar. But Russia killing everybody. Man, Russia don't care who any human being, whether it's man, woman, old woman, or children, or babies, they're killing them. They're raping the women. It's a lot of stuff going on there, man, and these people are really going through a lot. You know, so I feel like Ukraine is definitely standing in the need of prayer. And I feel like it's our job. We're obligated to lift them up in prayer. And I do believe that prayer will help, you know, some people. I really do that. I really believe that, because there are a lot of people that got testimonies over there, how they escaped the bullets. There's people that's in the hospitals, they shot up, but they're fine now. You know what I'm saying? They're taking care of them. You know, in other words, they didn't die. They're still alive. You know, there's people that just left the building and the whole building blew up. And then there's a lot of people who left the country, got made it by the grace of God, was able to leave the country. You know, they're somewhere else in Poland. Some of them way down there in Mexico. You know, I heard the United States is not letting them in. I don't know why. But yeah, that's a terrible thing. And I want to remind y'all about what Jesus said. Jesus says that in the last days, there will be wars and rumors of wars. He said these things must come to pass. See, that's what I like about the Lord, and that's what I like about the Bible. Having a Bible in your hand is like having a script to a movie. All you got to do is read that script, and you know how the movie is going to end. That's what I like about the Bible. It's like having a script, movie script in your hand. You can sit here and watch the script. You know what's about to happen next. You know what's about to happen next. Not I'm saying every detail by detail, but the Lord has given us signs because we are in the last days. The Bible in Daniel called this the Ancient of Days. We are in the last days. I know we think that this world is going to be around forever and ever and ever, but Jesus himself said that this world was going to end one day. That's what he said. Even the disciples knew that. They asked him a question. Jesus told the disciples, when the disciples were showing him, this is in Matthew chapter 24, and it's good to read like from verse 3 all the way to the end of the chapter. But like in verse 3 of Matthew chapter 24, the disciples pulled Jesus out, was showing him the temple. Because the temple back then was a big thing. This was the temple that was made, and it was made, you know, for God, for the Spirit of God to dwell in. And these men built this temple, and it was a fabulous temple. And they went to go show Jesus the temple to look at the temple, you know, show him the temple and stuff like that. Jesus, knowing the future of Jerusalem at that time, was letting them know that not one stone would be upon another, that this is going to be the abomination of desolation that Daniel spoke of. In other words, this city, this temple is going to be destroyed. That's basically what he was telling them. And he spoke of a future event that was going to take place. And this was like in 32 or 33 AD. He died. And we know he resurrected and went back up there to the Father. 40 years later, in 70 AD, the very thing that Jesus said was going to happen. Look it up, 70 AD. Read that scripture. Read that whole verse about them surrounding, Jerusalem and about them taking Jerusalem and he telling them that he need to escape from Jerusalem and things like that. Read that and then look up on your Google the siege of Jerusalem in 70 AD. That's 40 years later after what Jesus said. 40 years later, Titus, the Roman soldier, they surrounded Jerusalem, this great city. Jerusalem was a great city. It was like America. You know, it was flourishing. It was great. They call that the city of God. Why? Because because God was with them. You know, when they was with God, God was with them. But later on through time, they rejected God. You know, they rejected God. And when they rejected God, bad things happen when you do that. That's not good. So anyway, what I'm getting to is that how Jesus knew the future. He said this was going to happen. And in 70 AD, the Roman emperor, his name was Titus, him and his soldiers surrounded that city, just like Russia is surrounding Ukraine. Just like Russia invading Ukraine, that's the same thing they did to the city of God, which was Jerusalem. They surrounded that city. And I'm sure that they thought, oh, God is with us. You know, we know God is with us, but you living in sin. God is not with you when you living in sin. God has sent prophets to warn them, but they wouldn't listen. Anyway, what I'm getting to is that they surrounded that city and they came in there, the Roman soldiers. They killed a lot of people. They murdered a lot of people. Just like you seeing in Ukraine, that's the same way that's the same way the Roman soldiers was to the people in Jerusalem. You know, a lot of people fled, just like a lot of people fled. They said about 4 to 5 million people have fled already so far. That's the numbers we know. It could be greater than that. But a lot of people have fled from Ukraine and went into Poland. That's the same thing with the Jews did in Jerusalem. A lot of them that fled Jerusalem and went into other countries. That's how they got dispersed all around the world. But the people that stayed there, like the people that stayed in Ukraine, they got killed. You know, they got murdered. They got butchered. And they destroyed Jerusalem, and then they destroyed that temple. They smashed that temple where all the stones was down, flat on the ground. There was not one stone upon another, just like Jesus said. You know, so the reason why I went there is because when the Lord says that things are going to happen, that's why it's important to read the Bible. When the Lord tells you that things is going to happen, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And I'm not saying that he said anything that's going to happen to Ukraine. The Bible doesn't speak anything about Ukraine. It does speak about Russia. It talks about Babylon, which is America. But it doesn't say anything about Ukraine. But, you know, it's a lot of biblical prophecies, man. And, you know, a lot of times people don't like to hear anything about biblical prophecies, man. But I feel like that's why God wrote it. God wrote it, you know, for us to talk about, you know. So maybe one day we could get into that. You know, if y'all want to hear about that, y'all... let me know, and we could talk about that. If I see enough comments in the box, we could go ahead and start talking about that, because I would like to talk about that, because I feel you need to know. We need to know. You know, God written these things for a purpose, for a reason. Anyway, so basically what I'm saying is that, you know, the Lord said that there was going to be, in the last days, which that's what we're in right now, that's why it's important to get saved. Not tomorrow, not the next day, not later on this evening, not tonight when I go to bed. It's important right now, right now, to acknowledge that you are a sinner. Not to me, not to no priest. Get on your knees and pray to God through his son Jesus Christ. Acknowledge that you are a sinner. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible says everybody has sinned. Everybody. There's not one person that ever came on this earth and for the duration of his life he never sinned. So the Bible said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us have come short. And the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. That's the reward for your sin, death. Death is separation, being separated from God. And we don't want to be separated from God, because God is in heaven. We want to go up there with him. We don't want to go to hell, because when you're in hell, you're separated again from God. So anyway, to make a long story short, to acknowledge that you are a sinner, to confess your sins to God, because God says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's what God said. You know, he said he's faithful, he's just. All we gotta do is confess our sins to him. You know, if we ask God to forgive us, he will forgive us. But we have to do that. He said, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. If you don't confess, he can't forgive you. He only gonna forgive you if you confess. See, this is why it's messed up when people think they can live a life of sin, because when I die, God is going to forgive me. No, and you can't ask for forgiveness over there. This is something you have to do before you leave this world. This is why it's important to do this on a daily basis. God, if I did anything wrong today, forgive me. Lord, teach me, help me to walk right, to live holy. And he'll do it. He'll put his spirit in you, his Holy Spirit in you, and that Holy Spirit will do that. Anyway, so basically what I'm saying is that, you know, the Lord spoke about that these wars and rumors of wars, that will come, you know, and these are signs letting us know that we're in the end times. Basically, it's letting us know these things that we are seeing around us, this should make us appreciate where we at, be thankful for where we was born. Not get caught up in, oh, I was over here and they brought me over here. Get caught up. Be happy where you were born. It was meant for you to be right here. America is the greatest country in the world. Be thankful that this was where you was born. We have a lot of freedom here. A lot of freedom here that people in other countries do not have. So be thankful that you was born in America. You see this shirt? I'm thankful that I was born in America. I don't care what people think about America. I don't care how you feel about it over here. Oh, America ain't right. Oh, this don't belong to us. I don't care about none of that. I was born here. This is where God allowed me to be born at. And I, after going through other countries, see, a lot of times you got to leave where you at to be able to appreciate where you at. You know, I told y'all I live in Mexico. Mexico is nothing like America. It's cheap, but it ain't nothing like America. Nothing. America is the greatest. I'd have been to Jamaica. I'd have been to Canada. I'd have been to different places, man, different countries. And America is the best. I've done my researches on other countries online. Nothing like America, man. Greatest country in the world. Thank God that I came here, that I was born here. Anyway, so, you know, when you see that thing, those things going on over here, man, we got to be thankful, man, that we could go to sleep at night and sleep peacefully. You ain't got to worry about bombs and stuff like that, you know. Not to say that ain't going to happen in the future, but I don't want to talk about that. But anyway, so... Basically, what I'm saying is that, you know, we gotta we just got to be thankful for where we at, and we got to keep those people in prayer. You know, let's keep Ukraine in prayer. We're going to go ahead and lift them up in prayer right now. Y'all know I'm going to cut the lights off and play the music without the lyrics. And we're just going to lift up Ukraine in prayer. There's some others I'm going to lift up in prayer. There's some people that hit me up with a prayer request, you know, and we're going to lift them up in prayer individually. I'm going to call out their name. And I want you guys to continue to keep those people in prayer. Make a list, and every day you got something to pray about. So we're going to pray for Ukraine. We're going to pray for the people request over here. We're going to pray for also the people on Kingston Avenue in a hole. I'm going to be on my way back over there pretty soon. I am heading that way. It's going to take me a little time to get there because I got work to do before I get there. But I am heading that way. There's a girl, I think I told y'all before, named Rachel, that sent me like 4 big bags of clothes. And these people about to be blessed. She are 4 big bags of clothes. I'm talking about garbage bags that's full from the bottom all the way to the top. You know, I had to put all that in my truck. So I'm basically going to go there to, my plan is to go there to Kingston Avenue. I got some people that I want to look for. I want to look for Juan, you know, who got saved in season 2, and then he ended up bailing out. I know where he live at, so I'm going to go by there and check on him again. That's where his sister and her husband live at. I'm going to go check on Juan. I'm going to go check on Charles, which is Amber's friend. He's the one that whenever Amber need to run away from Kingston, she go run into his house, and plus she got a lot of clothes and shoes and stuff there, so she go there and change, take a shower and stuff like that. So I'm kind of close to him. Me and him talk a lot, you know. I'm gonna go visit him. I might try to see Hood Stunt while I'm down there if I got time. I do want to see him, but it's just, and you know, like I said, I want to pass out the clothes, and I also want to try to minister to some people, man, and just do that. So I am heading that way. I don't know when I'm gonna be there. I don't know how long it's gonna be. If it's gonna be a week or two, I don't know, but I am heading that way. And I just wanted to let y'all know that. So anyway, we're going to keep Kingston and Allegheny Avenue, all the people out there, the homeless people, the addicts out there, we're going to keep them in prayer. I know a lot of people don't. Sometimes you don't like to use the word addicts, but that's the truth. If you go look up the word addict, see what it says. You know, if you're hooked on anything like that, man, on drugs, you are an addict. You're a drug addict. You know, you only not an addict when you get off of that and you're free from that. It's like me. I used to be an inmate. I was an inmate for 23 years. I don't like that word, but that's the truth. I was housed in prison. That was my home, you know, for the 23 years I was there. I was an inmate. Am I going to tell you I'm an inmate now? No, I'm an ex-inmate. I ain't in there no more. You know, I used to be a gang member. I ain't no gang member no more. Now I'm an ex-gang member. So people that's addicts, when you get delivered off of that, then you become an ex-addict. You know, you're no longer an addict no more. A lot of times we don't like to hear the truth. I've seen videos when some of the people out there said, man, you know, this person said I was an addict and I ain't like that. But you on drugs. You stuck on these drugs. You're out here on the streets. You're doing these drugs every single day. You are an addict. That's the truth. You know, I don't know if you want me to paint an illusion around you. Oh, no, you're not an addict. You do drugs every day, but you're not an addict. You are an addict. Look up the word addict. And you tell me if I'm wrong when you look the word addict up and see if that fits somebody who's on drugs and use it every single day. That's like a man who drinks every day, all day, and he's been doing this for a long time, but he fights against you when you call him an alcoholic. Yeah, so anyway. Y'all know me, you know, y'all know me. I call it as it is. You know, I'm gonna keep it 100 with you. I'm gonna keep it 100 with whoever I talk to. They can either love it or hate it. That's the only thing I could say. You know, I'm a speak the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. No, ain't no sense of me lying to you. Ain't no sense of me trying to paint a beautiful picture for you. It is what it is. You know, a lot of times we need to be told our situation so we can hear it. We don't like it. Now it's our job to do something about it. Okay, well, he called me an addict. I don't like that. So I need to stop so I don't be called that again. That's basically what you need to do. But anyway, so we're about to enter into prayer. And We're going to lift up, like I said, the people in Ukraine in prayer. I want to say a special prayer for that woman who lost her son, who we just saw in this video. I'm going to have other videos coming up too, of footage. Maybe you guys haven't been seeing it. Sometimes, you know, you don't really watch the news, but you surf the internet and you'll see this channel. And so I'll make it a way for you to be able to see the news. So my next standing in need of prayer, I'm going to put that on there. I am going to get back to, after this video, the next one I post up on this channel is going to be, I did a Bible study showing you the difference between the King James Bible and the NIV. There is a difference. There's a big difference. If you ask me, I'm going to always tell you, get you a King James Bible. There's a history behind that, you know, and these other Bibles, man, the NIV, the Amplified Bible, all these things have words that's been taken away and added, you know. So, and God said, don't do that. God said for us not to add or take away from his word, you know, and all these Bibles have done that, but not the King James. You can trust in the King James. And, you know, and I know a lot of people say, well, King James, I heard King James was gay. I don't know what King James was, but King James had nothing to do with writing the Bible. He was the king at that time. And the reason why it's called, see, this is the thing. We call it the King James Bible, but we don't call it the correct word. The correct acronym for that is AKJV, which stands for Authorized King James Version. The reason why it was authorized, because he was a king at that time. And when they was translating Bibles, they wanted to translate the Bible from Hebrew and Greek into English so that we today can understand, you know, the words of God. So they had to get authorization from the king. All he did was say, yeah, go ahead. And he authorized it for them to do it. He didn't write not one period, not one comma, not one verse, not one chapter, not one scripture. Not one. So, you know, these little lies that people come up with is designed to keep us away from the Bible. You know, try the Bible yourself. Try read it for yourself. Try God for yourself. Don't let nobody tell you nothing about that book. But anyway, so that's the purpose of the King James Bible. And I show you. Watch that video. I'm going to be putting it up next. That I'm going to show you. There's a difference between the NIV and the King James Version. When I paint this out for you, there's nowhere in the world you cannot see this. You know, there's nowhere in the world you cannot see. You're going to be able to see, wow, look what they did to the Bible. Look what they took out, you know. So that's going to be coming up next. And then after that, I'm going to get in back into Matthew chapter 1. And we're going to be in, I think, verse 20 and 21. We're going to get back into that. You know, I haven't lost focus of that. I've been working. I've been busy. You know, but I'm going to get back into that. So anyway, let us go ahead and keep the people of Ukraine in prayer today. And let us do that every day. Also keep the people that's left prayer requests, you know, on here. Keep them in prayer. And let's continue to pray for those people in Kingston, Philadelphia. Amen. Keep me in prayer. Keep my family in prayer. And I'm going to keep your family in prayer. God bless you guys. Love you guys. And thank you for stopping by. Let's get ready to pray. Lights off. Amen. So, we're going to go ahead and get right on into the prayer. I want to start the prayer off for the people in Ukraine. Lord, Ukraine is standing in the need of prayer. Father, we stand in the gap with those people over there in Ukraine. Lord, as we watch the news, we see that they're going through heavy, heavy trials and tribulations. Father, people are being murdered over there. People are being shot. And Lord, some of the women are being raped. Some of them have even been raped in front of their own children. The Russians are cutting their tongues out. They're doing a lot of violence and wickedness over there, Lord. And Father, we just stand in the gap. Lord God, we pray for the people
in Ukraine, that they would use this moment, use this hour to draw close to you, Lord God. Father, they never thought about you before. We are praying that they will start thinking about you, that they will call out to you, that they will cry out to you. And Father, we pray that you would deliver them, Lord God, out of the hands of the enemy, that you would protect them, Lord God. Draw them close to you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. For those that who are hungry, Lord God, we pray that you feed them. For those who are thirsty, Lord God, we pray that you give them something to drink, Lord God. And Father, for those, Lord God, who life is on the line, Lord God, we're praying for miracles, Lord God, to rain down in that country and protect those, Lord God, from harm, hurt, harm, and danger, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we send a special prayer for the woman that was in the beginning of this video, whose son was shot and murdered right in front of her. Lord, she said that she fled, she ran for her life, and the Russians went inside and ate their food up and everything. Father, when she came back, she saw her son, her only son, on the road, dead. This woman had to pick up her son, 27-year-old son, and put him in a wheelbarrow, and she had to roll him back to the house and bury him in the ground. She said she put a rug over her son to protect him from being eaten by the dogs. Lord, we say a special prayer for this woman, because we know, we saw the tears, we felt her pain, and we stand in the gap for this woman in prayer. Father, we pray that you put your arms around this woman and comfort her and strengthen her as she go through these terrible times. Father, we pray that on a daily basis that you will provide for her the necessities of life, food, water, and Father, we pray that you protect her. Father, we know that she's not the only one, Lord God. We know that as we see the news, there's many people over there that are watching their mothers get killed in front of them. Fathers get killed in front of them. Children get killed in front of the parents. Lord, we just pray, Lord God, that you will have mercy on the souls in Ukraine. We pray, Lord God, that in this moment, that in this hour, that many of them will call out to you, Lord God. Cry out to you, Lord God, and ask you, Lord God, for help, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I've heard the president of Ukraine cry out for the UK to help him, for Poland to help him, for Europe to help him, for NATO to help him, and even the United States of America to help him. But Father, I pray that you will show him that he need to call out to you to help him. The whole country need to come to you and pray and ask you to help them. Because other people, Lord God, will forsake them. But you, if they call out to you, you will not forsake them. Father, we also want to stand in the gap for the people on this channel that has put in prayer requests. Father, we pray for Denise Maloney, who's going through another transition. Father, whatever it is that she's going through, Father, we're praying for her that you give her strength to go through whatever it is that she's going through. Father, we pray that you would put in her spirit that you love her and that she is not on this journey alone. You are with her in the name of Jesus. Father, we also pray for Sundance Girl. Lord, we pray for her to continue to stay in that word, so that that word would cause her to grow strong in the Lord and become a mature Christian. This is her prayer request. Father, we pray that she continue to have a desire to want to hear your word. Father, we know this journey sometimes get rough, Lord God, but Father, give her the strength, Lord God, to endure, because Jesus says if we endure to the end, we shall be saved. So we are praying for Sundance Girl to continue to be strong, continue to keep seeking your face, continue to keep reading that word and trusting you until the end. In Jesus' name. Father, we also want to stand in the gap for Racing K, better known as Kara. Father, we are praying for her because she is going through personal issues with her family. Lord, she has been clean for over a month, but the devil is attacking her on every side. And the sad thing about it, Lord, is sometimes the enemy is of our own household. That's what you said, Lord. You said that when we start reading your word and get that word in us, Lord, that our enemy will be of our own household, Lord. Father, we pray for Racing King. We pray for Kyle, Lord. We pray that she continue to be strong. She continue to seek your face. Lord, you put in my spirit, you gave me an example of us playing football, Lord. And when you catch the ball, it's not that easy to go make a touchdown, Lord. The enemy is always trying to knock the wind out of you, Lord. And that's how the devil is, Lord. The devil, once we catch that word and once we say we're Christians, the devil is always trying to stop us from getting into heaven, Lord God. He try to trip us. He try to knock the wind out of us, Lord. So, Father, I just pray for her, Lord, Racing K, that you continue to give her the strength. Let her know you love her and let her know that you are with her, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Father, I also want to say a special prayer for Michael T. He says he had a couple of days, a rough couple of days, Lord God, tough days. And Father, I just pray, Lord God, that you would give him strength to be able to overcome all the obstacles of the enemy, Lord God. Father, let him know that he is not on this journey alone, that he made the right decision to pick up that Bible and start reading and having a desire to want to know your word. Father, we pray for Michael T, that you will continue to walk with him, keep him in your word, in the name of Jesus. Father, we also want to pray for Irma. Father, we pray for Irma Medegoric. Father, she says that she doesn't want to start crying, but she needs deliverance. Father, I don't know what she needs to be delivered from, but you do. Father, we stand in the gap for her because we know it's not your will for any of us to be in bondage to anything. So, Father, whatever it is that she needs to be delivered from, Lord God, we stand in the gap for her and we pray for her deliverance. We pray that you will bring her out of bondage, whatever it is that got her bound, whatever it is that got her in captivity. We pray that she will be set free in the name of Jesus. Father, we also want to continue to pray for all those that we prayed the last time. We pray for Triple D. We pray, Lord God, for her situation. Father, we pray, Lord God, for my wife, that she continue, Lord God, to seek your face, that she continue, Lord God, to hold on to your hands in the name of Jesus. We have a praise report, brothers and sisters. The last time we did standing in the need of prayer, we had a guy that sent me a comment and said for us to pray for him because tomorrow he's going to be homeless. Well, we prayed for him that day, and I'm sure a lot of us continue to keep him in prayer. And he hit me up on another comment, and this is the comment right here, where he's basically letting us know that he is now off the streets and that he has a place to eat, sleep, and keep clean. Brothers and sisters, God, the God of heaven, is good. He answered our prayers, brothers And I ask that you continue to keep that brother in prayer, continue to keep everybody in prayer, continue to keep my wife in prayer, continue to keep me in prayer, and we will continue to keep you in prayer. We want to thank you. I want to thank everybody for being on this channel and being with us in prayer. God bless you guys. We love you guys. Until the next upload, I'm Joe the Street Preacher. And be safe out there, brothers and sisters. Good night.
It's me.